In this video, we're finding the area enclosed by a parametric curve called an astroid. And here's the equations for the astroid curve. And we have a plot down here with the area filled in. Now, the first thing that occurs to me is we should probably find the area enclosed by 1/4 of this thing and then just multiply the result by 4. So we'll do that when the time comes. And we'll just go ahead and pick the area in the first quadrant. And here's just a quick reminder of how you get the area for a parametric curve. There's a thin rectangular slice, and the height of that slice is just y of t for whatever moment in time t this is. And the width of this slice is just a little dx. So we can quickly say here that dA, the area contribution of that little slice, is going to be y of t times dx. And then we just replace dx with dx dt times dt. And it's probably more common to write this in prime notation. And so we immediately arrive at a formula for the area of a parametric curve. That's just the sum of all the area contributions. And we're going to go from t1 to t2 for whatever the situation is, y of t, x prime of t, dt. So before we set things up, we need to understand what the initial and final t values are. And if I just kind of mess around with it for a second in my head, I see that x of 0 is just 2 times the cosine of 0 cubed. In other words, just 2. And y of 0 is equal to 0 because I have the sine of 0 in that expression. And so the point 2, 0 corresponds to t equals 0. That's right here. And then I'm pretty sure that this little segment ends at t equals pi over 2. But just to verify it, x of pi over 2, that gives me a 2 times the cosine cubed of pi over 2, which is 0. And y of pi over 2, well, the sine function is 1 at t equals pi over 2, so I just get 2 out of this. And my intuition is correct on this. This is t equals pi over 2, where this little section terminates. So one tricky point here that actually matters for the calculation is that we just found the directionality of this parametric curve is going like this. And that means that my little dx is going to count as negative, and we're going to have to fix that when we set the integral up. So let's go ahead and get x prime of t to prepare for this integral. And I have to use the chain rule for this. I differentiate with respect to the cosine function, bring down the factor of 3, subtract 1 from that exponent. And then the chain rule says I need to multiply by the derivative of cosine, which is negative sine of t. And cleaning things up a little bit, that's negative 6 sine t cosine squared t. And I can see that when I'm talking about the first quadrant, the sine function is going to be positive. The cosine function is going to be positive. And there's a negative out in front of this, so I'm getting x prime of t is negative. So we're ready to set up our area integral. And I'm going to go ahead and put the factor of 4 out in front. It means we're just taking the area in that first quadrant and then quadrupling it. And our starting point for t is 0, and our finishing point is pi over 2. And y of t is 2 sine cubed t. And x prime, we just computed, is negative 6 sine t cosine squared t dt. Now with the sine and cosine both being positive when t is between 0 and pi over 2, I can tell immediately that my integrand is negative and that I'll get a negative area as a result of this negative dx issue, which you may also say is a negative x prime issue. And it seems like these sine issues crop up pretty frequently when we're doing calculus on parametric equations. And all I'm going to do is just fix it right now and say because the area has to count as positive, so because area is greater than 0. Now we can proceed with our integral. And I'm going to pull out a factor of 12 out in front and multiply by that 4, so I get 48. I have a total of sine to the 4th power. And then I have cosine squared. And this integral is pretty nasty. If you had an odd power of one of these trig functions, you could set things up to guess the antiderivative in just a couple steps. But when you have an even power of sines and cosines, we're going to have to reduce those powers by using the power reducing identities. So I'll just go ahead and store those over here on the left. These are ones that are so useful that I actually have them memorized. It's not true for all identities. When you're stuck with even powers of sine and cosine in an integral, you're always going to end up using these guys. So I'm going to think about this as sine squared squared, and I see that the sine squared has this nice identity to it, so let's go ahead and apply that at the same time. And then I have a cosine squared, that's another 1/2, and a 1 plus cosine 2t. So I end up with three factors of two in the denominator from all these 1/2, and that's a 1/8. And if I move the 1/8 out in front, it cancels an 8 out of the 48, leaving me with a 6. Now I have three binomials to multiply. So 1 minus cosine 2t twice, and then a 1 plus cosine 2t. And the way I'm going to think about this is I'm going to multiply one of those 1 minus cosine 2t's by the 1 plus cosine 2t, because that creates a difference of 2 squares, and it's very easy to write that down. So I just get 1 minus cosine squared 2t. And now I have these two binomials left to multiply. I'm going to start giving myself some more room here. So when I do FOIL on this, I get 1 minus cosine squared 2t minus cosine 2t plus cosine cubed 2t. And let's not forget the 6 out in front of that. All right, at this point, I'm going to clip out this integral and go to a new slide. So here we go. And when I check this integral out, I notice that there are two pieces left inside that are non-trivial. So there's a cosine squared piece and a cosine cubed piece, each of which requires their own particular manipulations. And I think I'm going to go ahead and just split this thing into four separate integrals just to spread it out, and we'll put it all back together at the end. So first, I have an integral from 0 to pi over 2. We'll remember to multiply by 6 at the end of 1 dt, which is just t evaluated from 0 to pi over 2. And this gives me pi over 2. So that takes care of that first term. Then I'm going to go ahead and write down the integral of cosine squared 2t from 0 to pi over 2. We're not going to forget that minus sign when we put everything back together at the end. And I have to use the power reducing identity again on this. And this time, twice the angle gives me a 4t. And when I integrate this, I get a t from that first term, the 1. And then I get a 1/4 sine 4t, just accounting for the chain rule backwards from 0 to pi over 2. And on the sine term, something really convenient happens. If I plug in pi over 2 for t, it gives me the sine of 2 pi, which is 0. Plug in 0 for t, I get sine of 0, which is 0. So that term is gone. And I'm left with only one survivor here. It's when I plug in pi over 2 for t, and I end up with a 1/2 pi over 2, or pi over 4. Next, we'll do the integral from 0 to pi over 2 of cosine of 2t, and this is ready to guess the antiderivative. This gives me a 1/2 sine 2t, the 1/2 just to account for what the chain rule does when I differentiate the sine of 2t. And this is evaluated from 0 to pi over 2. And the same sort of thing happens. If I plug in t equals pi over 2, I get the sine of pi, which is 0. Plug in t equals 0, and I get the sine of 0, which is 0. So that term vanishes. And then finally, I look at the integral from 0 to pi over 2, cosine cubed 2t. And the standard way to handle this is to split off a factor of cosine. And that leaves me with a factor of cosine squared, but that can be replaced with 1 minus sine squared using that Pythagorean identity. And so this splits into two terms. I have a cosine 2t, and I have a negative cosine 2t sine squared 2t. And the whole point of what we've done here is that we have the derivative of sine 2t sitting right next to a power of sine 2t, so it allows me to do the chain rule backwards. Now, I don't quite have the derivative of sine 2t because that's cosine 2t times 2, and we'll adjust for that when we take the antiderivative. So doing my first term here, I have a 1/2 sine 2t from 0 to pi over 2. Again, that's going to vanish because it gives me the sine of pi minus the sine of 0. And then in my second term, I'll just leave the minus sign out in front. I'm going to have a 1/3 sine cubed 2t. But then when I differentiate that, I would bring down the power of 3. I would get sine squared 2t times the derivative of sine 2t, which is cosine 2t, so that's good. But then it would be multiplied by 2. So if I differentiate this, it's too large by a factor of 2. So I compensate with a factor of 1/2. Again, we evaluate from 0 to pi over 2. And I see that this gives me a sine cubed of pi, which is 0, and a sine cubed of 0, which is 0. So again, all of those terms are gone. Okay, then I can go back to my original integral and plug all this stuff in. So I had a 6 out in front, remember. And then my first term integrated to just pi over 2. And my second term, well, it had a minus sign in front of it, and it integrated to pi over 4. And then my last two terms, they totally vanished. So those are gone. If you're curious why those two terms came out to zero, you can actually see this coming by looking at the symmetry of these graphs. So cosine of 2t is just a cosine wiggle with a period of pi. And that means we're integrating cosine 2t on the first half period. If you go and look at a graph of this, you can tell immediately it spends half its time above the t-axis and half below. So you can see these two coming by investigating their graphs. And then depending on the context of what class you're taking, you may or may not have to actually prove it algebraically. So I just included the whole thing. Okay, simplifying pi over 2 minus pi over 4. That's 2 pi over 4 minus 1 pi over 4. Leaving me with just a pi over 4 in there, and I can clean things up just a little, canceling a factor of 2. I find that the total area enclosed in this asteroid curve is 3 pi over 2, and we're done. If you find the math content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce dozens of new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.